poor in spirit, those who see the sin in their hearts. Blessed are the ones who are weeping, 'cause sin has torn the whole world apart. Blessed are the meek and humble, God will freely give them all things. Blessed are the ones who are hungry and thirst for justice and wait on their King. Shake, shake, shake like a salt shaker. And we are the light of the world, so we're gonna shine, shine, shine till the night's no more. We're gonna shine, shine, shine till the night's no more.
Good morning. Welcome to the house of our Lord. This morning we have a few announcements for you. First of all, Aspire. It's the women's event that we were going to go to. It was before all of the COVID stuff hit, and then it was delayed. We have an understanding that it might be able to happen in November. So we will keep that in prayer. It's supposed to be a wonderful event for our women in the church. And then if you have any needs or any conversation that you want to have, please feel free to give me a call. I can be reached anytime. If it happens that you get my voicemail, leave a detailed message and I will call you back as soon as I can. There are still lots of things to be done in this church, and so even though we are not having church in our building, there are still a lot of things that we can do to make it look better and beautiful for when we return. And this is a great time to be doing work in and around the church. So contact Jan if you want to help out to make God's house look a little bit better. And then we have Bible study. Bible study is on Thursday mornings at 10 a.m. through Zoom. And contact me if you would like to do that. It is a great little Bible study for 1 hour a day, a week, and we have a lot of fun. We have a birthday and an anniversary to celebrate, and I'm going to preface this with saying if you haven't given me your birthday or anniversary information, will you please do that? I figured out one day too late that it was the Solanskis' anniversary, so that was yesterday, and I hope that your day was amazing. And then tomorrow we have a birthday. Shelley has her birthday tomorrow, so we hope that that is an amazing day for her. Help them celebrate, lift them up in prayer, give them a phone call, let them know that you're thinking of them. Now we are going to join in as we can for the call to worship. Some of you may want to join in right there at home and say the call to worship with me. Others might want to just listen, so whichever is comfortable for you, let's join in for the call to worship. Welcome to the community of faith, the family of God. We come as families, large and small in number, seeking God's love. God's love is here for you. Help us to understand how we are connected to God. We abide in Christ Jesus in love and compassion. May our spirits be renewed and our connection to God be strengthened through our worship today. Amen. Would you join me in prayer? God, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us. We ask that you help us to focus on you this morning for just this small period of time. Help us to clear away all the other distractions. Help us to focus on you and to understand your word and your love and your compassion for us. Help us to understand that we are your children. And while we can't possibly understand the depth of your love, help us to know that it's there. In your son's name, amen. Let's start our morning with a little bit of worship music.
There is no problem too big, God cannot solve it. There is no mountain too tall, he cannot move it. There is no storm too dark, God cannot calm it. There is no sorrow too deep, he cannot soothe it. If he carried the weight of the world upon his shoulders, I know, my brother, that he will carry you. If he carried the weight of the world upon his shoulders, I know, my sister, that he will carry you. He said, come. Cannot solve it. There is no mountain too tall, he cannot move. is no storm too dark God cannot calm it. There is no sorrow too deep He cannot soothe.
It's time for our joys and concerns. So this morning, I want to start with our joys and concerns for travel mercies. We have people that are still traveling. We have Mary and Roger that are traveling for several days, so we ask for prayers for them. And for those that are still vacationing, the last part of vacation before school starts again, we lift them up in prayer. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. And then for those that are sick and having a tough time, for those that maybe just have allergies, or for those that just woke up this morning not feeling very good, and thinking that it's just going to be a long day, we keep you in prayer. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. And we continue to lift up our teachers as they prepare. I think they're going to start preparing, if they haven't already, in the next week or so, for what school looks like for all of our kids. No matter what county we are looking at, no matter what state we are looking at, this is going to be tough for kids and for teachers. So for the teachers who have to show guidance and leadership, even when they don't know quite how this is going to happen. And then for the kids, I know that for Allie, the school is starting a couple of weeks later than they anticipated because of what is going on in California. So for all of our kids, for all of our teachers, we lift them up in prayer. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. If you have prayer requests, feel free to text message those to me, to give me a call, to email them prior to service, and I will be happy to do the prayer request just like we always do. It will be a generic form rather than speaking names for your confidence, for your privacy, unless you tell me otherwise. So let us bow in prayer and join together, because even though we are generalizing our prayers, God knows the specifics. Let us pray. God, we thank you for hearing our prayers, for those that are traveling, for those that are not feeling well this morning, for our teachers, for our students, and for all of the prayers that are not heard right now in this house, you hold them in your heart. You hold them and care for those prayers and answer those prayers in your time. So God, we lift each and every prayer up to you, those spoken and not. And let us come together as we unite in the prayer that your Son taught others, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This would normally be the time where we have our tithes and offerings. And just a quick reminder, when you send in your tithe, thank you so much. We really appreciate it. And we join you in prayer that God magnifies all that he gives, that you give, and he blesses you with. Let us join together in the doxology. God, we praise you, from whom all blessings flow. We praise you as the creatures here below. God, we praise you above. You are our heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Join me in prayer. God, thank you. Thank you for the offerings and the tithes and the gifts that are received. Take what it is that has been offered and magnify it. Use it to reach your people and to glorify you. In your Son's name, amen. This morning's scripture comes from Acts 28, 1 through 6. I understand that it has a little bit of a different scripture up there, and all scripture is amazing. But for this morning, we are talking about Acts 28, verses 1 through 6. And Luke is telling this story in Acts. Hear the words of our Lord from the Message version of scripture. Once everyone was accounted for and we realized that we had all made it, we learned that we were on the island of Malta. The natives went out of their way to be friendly to us, and the day was rainy and cold, and we were already soaked to the bone. But they built a huge bonfire and gathered us around it. Paul pitched in and helped. He had gathered up a bundle of sticks, but when he put it on the fire, a venomous snake roused from its tuber by the heat and struck his hand and held on. Seeing the snake hanging from Paul's hand like that, the natives jumped to the conclusion that he was a murderer, getting his just deserts. Paul shook the snake off into the fire, none for the worse for wear. They kept expecting him to drop dead, and when it was obvious that he wasn't going to, they jumped to the conclusion that he must have been a god. These are the words of our Lord. Praise be to God. This morning's passage, this morning's sermon is titled, The Power of God Rests on You. We come to a point where Paul was a prisoner. The story, like I said, is told from Luke's perspective, and he was with Paul on the journey that we're about to talk about. Paul was a prisoner. He was charged in Caesarea for inciting riots, accused of talking to the Greeks about God. See, no one was supposed to be in the temple but for the Jews. And if Paul brought the Greeks into the temple, well, that was just a crime. No one but the Jews were supposed to be in the temple. He was found guilty, even though he wasn't. See, the Greeks never were in the temple. People saw others passing by the temple, so the Jews saw non-Jewish people passing by the temple, and they were just convinced that they actually had gone in, and Paul had allowed it to happen. Those that were against Paul were not very happy that he was preaching to those that were not Jewish to begin with, and they were not happy that he was spreading the news of Christ. But Paul was a Jew himself, and he knew better than most the rules and the laws, and he knew that he was not allowed to bring the Greeks into the temple. Yes, the news of Christ was for every person, but he also was a Jew, and he wanted to honor that heritage. And so he wasn't going to do anything that would upset those that were around him. And even so, even as careful as he was still charged, tried, and found guilty. And this is where we pick up our story, because now they're sailing to Rome. And as a prisoner, Paul was with many other prisoners as they sailed for Rome. Yet it was the absolute wrong time to be sailing. And what I find funny is that Paul had tried to tell them that this was the wrong time, that this was the stormy time of year, but they were not going to listen to Paul. They were not going to listen to this prisoner. They were not going to listen to this person who thinks he knows everything. So off they went, the powers that be, the authorities that decided that it was okay to load all of the cargo, to load the prisoners, to load those that were off and running. See, they had a shipment, and they were taking the load, the cargo, to Sicily, to Italy, so that they could get paid. And so they didn't care whether it was the wrong time of the year. It was roughly around October or November. And storms were frequent during this time of year, and this was no exception. And so certainly what happens in this passage is the ship gets caught in this massive storm, and it breaks apart. And they are fortunate enough to be close enough to an island. And so while the ship is breaking apart, they swim to this island. And they get to the island, and they are absolutely exhausted. And they are cold, and it is windy, and it is rainy. It is the type of storm that breaks ships apart. That's what they walk into as they get to the island. And now they're just absolutely frigid with cold, because I'm sure in October or November, the ocean isn't very warm. They find out later that they have hit the island of Malta. Malta is about 58 miles south of Sicily. They were kind of close to where they were supposed to get to, and it was 18 miles long and 8 miles wide. And in fact, it is still around today, and it is a great vacation spot. And there is a northeastern shore that is called St. Paul's Bay. Yes, that is where the ship fell apart and all on the ship ended up, on the northeastern shore of St. Paul's Bay. Well, after making it to the shore, they realized that they were on Malta. Now, how did they realize that? Well, there were some natives that joined them, that met them as they were coming out of the water and coming up onto the island. The natives somebody must have spoken the native language of Punic on the ship. They must have understood, because they understood that the natives were very friendly. They understood the natives saying the island of Malta. They understood that the natives were going to help them to build a fire, to get warm, to take care of them. It's funny, though. Perception can be everything sometimes. In fact, Paul found himself in trouble originally because of perception. Paul was judged and believed to have gone against God's word, bringing non-Jews into the temple. What was Paul thinking? The temple had been set aside by the Jews. Only the Jews were allowed, not those that don't know God, not those that don't dress and speak and behave well, not those people, not those sinners, and not those that aren't from this community. Shame on you, Paul. What nonsense that the temple would be used for people other than the Jewish people. And yet, it occurs to me that the natives on Malta, were just the opposite of those that condemned Paul. It should have been the other way around, but it wasn't. So the natives were friendly people, and they were welcoming, and they believed that anyone that came to their island were treated with kindness until they proved to be otherwise, until it needed to be otherwise. So as the men swam to shore, the natives were watching it all happen, were watching the struggle and trying to figure out how to be hospitable, trying to figure out how to care for these strange men who were strange enough to be in this kind of weather. Sailing? Really? Didn't they know any better? Warmth was needed, and the natives knew that. And so they built this huge bonfire to help all of the men to get warm and dry before the darkness overcame them. Well, as you know, when you build a fire, you need lots of wood, and Paul was the helpful kind of guy. He wasn't the kind that would just stand around waiting for someone else to do the work. So he helped to gather the wood. In the process of gathering the wood, he was bit by a snake. Paul had a bundle of sticks that he was bringing to the fire, and as he got closer to the fire, that meant that bundle that was in his arms was getting warmer. And as it was getting warmer, it woke up the snake that happened to be inside the bundle of wood that he had grabbed, not realizing. Well, the snake was aroused, and it did what a snake will do when it is surprised. It bit Paul. And then it hung on. And I can just imagine that as it's biting, it's hanging down and the tail is kind of flopping around, and there's this bite right there on Paul's hand, and it would be definitely pretty startling for those that are watching. Probably it should have been startling for Paul. Scripture says that this was a venomous snake and it was hanging on for dear life. Maybe it was as much as 18 or 24 inches long, enough to be dangling with its claws clenched around Paul's hand. Based on what happens next, perception was everything. There's a political consultant by the name of Lee Atwater who's attributed with a well-known saying which says, perception is everything. Well, as that saying has changed through the years, it has metamorphosed into perception is reality. I don't know about you, but often I get myself in hot water as a direct result of my perception being everything and being my reality. As an example, at the end of the last school year, Allie was supposed to be doing her schoolwork on the computer, and she is an amazing student. I have not had to do anything to try to hurry her along, and I don't know why I perceived something different this time, but as I walked by, I noticed that she was watching a movie on her computer, and I didn't ask any questions. I didn't try to clarify any of the information. I perceived that she was just sloughing off, and so I'm sure that I made some comments to that effect. Well, unfortunately for me, Allie was actually doing her homework, her schoolwork. She was looking for a movie clip for a project. Perceptions can be inaccurate, can't they? It certainly was in that example, and I've got many more of them for you, and I'm sure that you could share some with me as well. Perceptions are not only inaccurate, they bring judgment. The natives believed that the snake was poisonous, and that any snake that was poisonous that bit anyone, well, what that meant was that the God of justice was getting even with a murderer. That's what they believed. And then based on that perception, there comes judgment and belief. See, the natives jumped back. They no longer were friendly. They no longer were hospitable. They were no longer willing to be in the company of Paul. The judgment, automatically the natives in their judgment thought that they were better than Paul. Paul was a murderer. Paul deserved to die from this venomous snake. The natives, as kind-hearted as they were, did they have the right information? See, they took a set of facts and they created their own truth. They formed their own opinion and they condemned before asking any clarifying questions. And they played God based on their perception, their judgment, and their belief. I came across a cartoon when I was preparing this sermon. And in this cartoon, it had a picture of a man. And on one side, it was a man. On the other side, a man, the exact same man. Exactly. Same hair, same facial expressions, same clothes being worn, exactly the same. But the only difference was one man had no glasses on, the other man had glasses on. And then at the bottom of the picture with one with no glasses had the word cool. And at the bottom of the one with glasses, it had the word smart. The perception was the glasses made this person go from cool to smart. Why couldn't he have been both? Or maybe neither perception was correct. We pass judgment based on looks. We pass judgment based on whether people go to church or not. We pass judgment based on what people dress or how they dress. We pass judgment based on how people speak, what their hair looks like, whether or not they have acne, whether or not they have missing teeth, whether or not they have a good home or any home, the car they drive. I can go on and on for how we pass judgment. And we can be cruel, and passing judgment can be harmful. And it can lead people to turn away from God. It can lead people to turn away forever. Judgment can hinder spreading God's word. If Paul was a normal person like you and I, if he wasn't so stubborn about spreading God's word, judgment from others could have stopped him right in his tracks from spreading God's word. If what people said or the perceived about him mattered, Paul would have stopped spreading God's word because he would have wanted to stop being judged, stop being harmed physically and emotionally. And yet Paul was willing to continue to spread the word of God. He was willing even though he was physically harmed. He was willing even though he feared for his life. Paul was willing to carry on with the good news and spreading the word of God even though it cost him his freedom. Even though it cost him his life. Paul understood what many of us don't. The power of God rests within us. The power of God overcomes perception and judgment. Listen to the words of God. Paul shook the snake off into the fire, none the worse for wear. They kept expecting him to drop dead, but when it was obvious that he wasn't going to, they jumped to the conclusion that he was a god. Let's explore what this passage does not say. This passage doesn't say that Paul was in fear after the snake bit him, because he wasn't. The passage doesn't say that Paul questioned whether or not the snake was poisonous, because it didn't matter to him. The passage does not say Paul took advantage of the belief that the natives thought he was a god, because what they thought was not relevant. None of that mattered to Paul. He knew God's power, and he knew that God's power rested with him. He knew God had the ultimate power, and God gave Paul power, and God took away power as he saw fit. Isn't that what the moment on the road to Damascus was all about, when Paul met Jesus? Isn't that what it was about? The power of Christ resting on Paul and remaining with Paul. Paul knew at that very minute and for the rest of his life that the power of God rested with him, and he never forgot it. He never forgot where the power came from, and he built his life around God and God's power that was given to Paul for a certain purpose, to spread the word of God. God gives his people the skills, the courage, and the timing that is needed to do his will. Perception and judgment, they're not relevant at the point where God steps in. What others think about your strengths or your weaknesses, it doesn't matter once God steps in. What others believe about your abilities simply doesn't matter when God steps into your life. Sometimes we have to ignore the perceptions of others. We need to not be in someone else's reality. This week, as you go forward, remember not to be in someone else's reality. Remember to be in God's reality and to rest with him. Amen.
Oh, Lord above.
this week, I pray that we leave the perceptions and judgments to God. And while we are aware of the enemy, we turn our focus to him and on him, that being God, not the enemy. Sometimes we are so aware of the enemy that we turn our focus to him. That's not what I want for any of us this week. This week, even though there's an awareness of the enemy, let us be focused on God. Let him deal with the snakes in the grass. Amen.